today, gang? To worship the Lord. Amen, amen. We're in a series on the book of Acts, and we're in Acts chapter 15 today. Say Acts 15. If I hadn't met you before, my name is Nate. I'm the pastor around here, and we're just so honored and humbled you chose to worship with us today. We got an important announcement at the end of this service today, and I'm going to leave it cryptic right there and not talk about it again until I get done preaching, because I want all your attention while I'm preaching. He might say something, you know. So at the end of the sermon, it's a very encouraging, important thing we're going to be praying over, and God's leading us through some open doors, and we're excited about it. On Wednesday nights, we're taking this series on the book of Acts, and we're going deep with it. So if you want to get your Bible nerd on and you want to get into some Bible study, that is what Wednesday nights are all about. And we're looking at the book of Acts because the book of Acts is telling this story. It's telling this story about what the church of Jesus is like. I didn't say was, I said is. Because I'm speaking of the Bible stories as if they were possible today. As if the same Spirit of God that we sang about earlier that worked in that church works in this church. Amen. Thanks, John. Appreciate that. This is the Holy Spirit working in the local church. These are the first stories we have out of the Bible about what a church that has the Holy Spirit infilling, the Holy Spirit power, the Holy Spirit visitation. These are the stories of what that church does and who that church is. And if we lean into it, we will learn a couple of things. And we're saying some of the same things every week. The first thing is this, that the Holy Spirit is doing something within you that will live beyond you. Could you read that with me? The Holy Spirit is doing something within you that will live beyond you. Now take that word you and change it to me. The Holy Spirit is doing something within me that will live beyond me. And each week, there's a key question. The book of Acts is showing us these things. It's showing us what the Holy Spirit's doing. But there's a key question that we have for you. The question is this, is where do you fit in today's story? Where do you fit in the chapter of Acts that we're going to be talking about today? Lean in. Get curious. Use your imagination. If you were among the people that were living through this story at that time, who would you be? Who do you want to be? Who is God calling you to be? We're in Acts chapter 15. We're going to start in verse 1, and we're going to read these first two verses because it sets up everything that we're going to be talking about today. And it goes like this. While Paul and Barnabas were at Antioch of Syria, some men from Judea arrived and began to teach the believers, "Unless you are circumcised as required by the law of Moses, you cannot be saved." Paul and Barnabas disagreed with them, arguing vehemently. Finally, the church decided to send Paul and Barnabas to Jerusalem, accompanied by some local believers, to talk to the apostles and elders about this question. Without me going into very explicit detail, does anybody not understand what circumcision is? Yeah, that you can kind of giggle at that. That's okay. If you don't understand what circumcision is, I would invite you to go to Google and turn all the filters off. I've got doctors in the room telling me, no, don't do that. If you don't know what it is, you need to go educate yourself because it's a very sensitive subject. It's a very sensitive thing, circumcision. And what we have happening in a local church is that you've got some Jewish believers who are saying you can't be saved unless you get that surgical procedure done. That's what they're saying. These people are way past us in mandating anything. Can you imagine during any time in history, if you came to church and the message was, unless you're circumcised, we're going to show you the door. You can't be a part. You can't. Listen, we can't even get our people agreeing to wear masks. What's circumcision going to do to the opinions in the room, okay? I mean, just think about it for a minute, then retreat off of that subject. That is, talk about a divisive topic. And why is this opinion so important? And some of you are like, man, I didn't know he was going to talk about circumcision. We got a great kids ministry. Pastor Lily and her gang, I'd invite you to this is for people who like to consider themselves adults. None of y'all are adults. You're a bunch of kids, in my opinion. So am I. That's why some of you giggled as soon as you saw circumcision in Scripture. But yeah, this is the dividing topic in that church. Even thousands of years ago, there were opinions and divisive topics in the church. And you know what? It's a part of the history. And it's going to be a part of the future because human beings, you and me, and even some of those teenagers that you question if they're alien or if they're human, we all have these opinions. We all have things we study or things that we learn or things that we believe. And sometimes we get so opinionated on them, we push our opinions and our beliefs on other people, and then we attach whether it's right or wrong to do this. And sometimes, I know this would never, ever happen in this church, but sometimes opinions get so heated that we just walk away from each other and say, I'm out. I'm so ticked that this guy didn't believe what I believed. Or that pastor didn't say what I believed, and we walk away from fellowship with each other over something. And why is it so important? It was so important in this early church because these Jewish believers, these Jewish people who were saying these things that everybody needed to get circumcised, they were saying it because that's what they had done their whole lives in their religion. Like they had grown up in a rich history and a rich tradition, and a tradition where legal matters, law, legalism, that kind of stuff, like they were really into tithing, and they would even tithe their herbs and their spices to their tabernacles, to their churches. Like they were so into, and so they were not about to let some people come in and receive the gospel of Jesus without having this rich history. And I can kind of understand that. I can kind of understand it because I'm in my 40s now, and I see people in their 20s doing things, living their life, YOLO, FOMO, whatever-o, you know. I'm getting to be an old fuddy-duddy, and I can see them walking through life, and everything seems so easy, and I'm like, y'all don't understand how hard I had it when I was your age. And I remember back in my 20s when my parents are sitting right there. They probably looked at me and they thought, he just doesn't get it, what hard work it takes. And then my grandparents would say things like, I used to walk uphill barefoot in the snow both ways to school. You know, all this stuff. And I see people under the age of 30 and 20 just sitting there shaking their heads like, yep, all these old people got advice for me, buddy. I know it. But I can kind of understand it. But if you're having trouble understanding where I'm coming from, there's this fantastic device that has been created. You ever watch that show Shark Tank? It's not actually about like real sharks. It's a business show. People come up with their ideas, and they pitch their ideas to these investors, and they're like, thumbs up, thumbs down. I'll give you $1 million, you know, whatever, if it's a good product. There was this one product that was, I'll tell you what. Well, I'll just show you a little bit of the episode. You'll get the concept, and then we'll loop back around. This is going to tie back to circumcision. This is not a circumcision product. Let me state that up front, okay? This product has nothing to do with any kind of surgery, okay? But just watch this, and then we'll loop back around. Here we go.
It's Travis Perry. My product is Cord Buddy. I've come to the Shark Tank to ask for $125,000 for a 10% equity stake in my business. My love is music. I have taught thousands of people to play the guitar. Sadly, I've seen thousands quit. The guitar is the most popular instrument in the world, but yet it is one of the most frustrating. We all want to play the guitar for one reason. You know what it is? To meet chicks. But what if a product existed where you could push a button and play a song and learn the guitar with no frustration? With sharks, there's no what if. It exists. And it is the award-winning Chord Buddy. There's four buttons. It plays G, D, C, and E minor. With those four chords, you can play hundreds of thousands of songs.
David Chandler, I watched you playing acoustic guitar earlier today in the worship set. He's sitting up there. He's worked at chord structures for years. And this guy with Chord Buddy has taken all that work and just put it in a little button. Ticks me off. Some of y'all are like, I want to play guitar. What's that called? Chord Buddy? What's that chord? There's a silent H. Got it. Chord Buddy. Ticks me off. You know why it ticks me off? Because, man, some of y'all don't know this about me. I was a music major and when I was an undergrad for a couple of years before I went to seminary. And I played brass instruments. I worked very hard at being a music major. I took music theory, where you learn what notes are, you learn the circle of fifths, you learn the rest, you learn the chord progressions, you learn the seventh chords, you learn all these things. I took ear training, where you listen to a piece of music, and then you wrote it out, and you learned how to write music. I went to practice like two or three times a day. I took classes on music literature where we studied the composers from the beginning of when music happened way back in the Gregorian chants days that we have like in our history. I studied music literature. It was painstaking. I put hours and hours, and I had to take piano. And for me, a piano, this is a very complicated instrument. There's 88 keys right here, and it doesn't play when I play it, apparently. But there's all these keys, and there's chord structures. And when I took piano, they gave me a piece of music, and it had four lines of music on it. And you had to read all four lines at the same time and play the chord progressions. And this guy on Shark Tank takes all of that work and puts it in a button. Bling. Ticks me off. David, doesn't it tick you off? It ticks us off. Anybody can play guitar. You may not be able to carry a note, but you can put Chord Buddy on your guitar. Some of y'all are buying Chord Buddy today because you got an old guitar in the closet and you're like, I didn't know we could do that. And it took years and years and years of music training. Jimi Hendrix is turning over in his grave because it ain't right. It's not fair. But if you don't really know anything about music, this is awesome. This is incredible. Imagine being a great guitar player. On one hand, you're happy that folks can play. On the other hand, you're like, but they didn't have to work hard for it. They just got to do that. And if you watch that episode even further, the device comes apart in different ways, and it actually teaches you chord structures in a very easy way. And this is similar to what's going on in the book of Acts right now. In Acts 15, there's this teaching that Paul and Barnabas have come to the church with, and it's saying Jesus Christ, because of his death, his resurrection, because of who he is, Jesus Christ has taken all the law, all the prophets, everything in Judaism, all the 700 and some odd laws, everything from the Ten Commandments of Moses, all the history, he has fulfilled all of it, and all you have to do is follow Jesus in his way, and you are saved. You are good. And I tell you what, for me, a guy here in 2022, somebody I know my depravity very well, I am so thankful for Jesus. But in Acts 15, you got these religious people who have been doing the work year after year after year, and they're like, you got to be kidding me. They don't even have to go to Jesus class 101. They don't even have to work hard at it. It's like they got a chord buddy for their soul. and they just have to push the red button and they get the chord of G. And these people are ticked about it. God's rescue is for everyone, open and free. And it's too easy. And these Jews that heard this message became angry because they didn't see how the accessibility was a good thing. They saw compromise. That's what they saw. They saw that Jesus and this way and this good news is way too easy. And okay, we like Jesus, we like all this, we believe it's a fulfillment, but you also got to do some of the hard work. You can't just have Jesus and that be enough. You've got, you know what we ought to do? Let's get them in on the original covenant stuff. Circumcision. If you want Jesus, we're not going to let you just have cord, buddy. We're going to throw circumcision on top of that. Well, don't you think that putting circumcision is going to kind of help some people select out of this whole Jesus thing? No? AFA here in Alabama, y'all were good with circumcision in order to have salvation. Is that what I'm hearing? I'll try this again. Don't you think that circumcision might not be the way, but Jesus might be the way? Okay. Some of y'all still are like on the circumcision bandwagon. We'll get you converted soon. I've got an illustration later. You're not going to like it at all. But they saw compromise all those years, keeping themselves distinct. Fully Jewish, following the laws, keeping from away from the pagan lifestyle. They suffered mockery and oppression. They, even to this day, good Jewish men and women suffer mockery for how that they dress and how they keep their hair and how they eat kosher and how they do it. And all these pagans, all these Gentiles are now coming into their world. There was a righteous indignation. And so the church in Acts 15 has this problem. The church has a problem. See, there are these good guitar players who don't want other fake guitar players to play. There's longtime Jewish people with a long history, and they've worked hard to understand Messiah and everything, and they've gone to all the classes, and they've taken all the Enneagram and personality stuff. They've gone to the worship conferences, and they've gone to the teachings, and all of a sudden, these people who just showed up and haven't done anything are getting access and being welcomed to sit front row at their concert. And this argument over surgery, that's the covenant, that's the sign. And Paul and Barnabas are in this church, and they hear this, and we have this conflict in the church, and what do they decide to do? They decide not to just say, y'all are wrong, we are right. They decide, you know what? We're not going to create cancel culture in the church. That's not what they did. They disagreed with the circumcision guys. And Paul, we'll see later, disagrees with them very strongly. I think it said vehemently in the scripture we read. But they don't cancel each other. They don't walk away from each other. They don't break fellowship over this. What they do is they lean in and they pray and they go and they seek the wisdom of the apostles. They go and instead of splitting the church, what they do is they lean in. And can you imagine a preacher standing up and saying, look, I know that this group believes that we should do something this way and this group believes that we should do something this way. Instead of choosing one of those, I'm going to appeal with other pastors and we're going to take this to prayer and we're going to see what we feel like God and His Spirit are saying, and we're just going to do what we feel like God is saying for the whole church. And you might can imagine a preacher standing up and doing it, but can you imagine a church where this side of the room feels one way and this side of the room feels another way, and all of them are like, well, yeah, we're just going to go ahead and do what we feel like God's. You pastors, you leaders, you authority, y'all pray. Y'all seek God. We'll pray. We'll fast. We will not consider this just a disagreement. We will consider this as something that will strengthen us if we submit ourselves to prayer. Can you imagine? Can you imagine a church that says, well, you're welcome here, and you can worship here, but you just have to do these things. You've just got to have this surgery. You've just got to do this thing, and you're welcome here. Do we struggle with this kind of thing in our churches today? I don't really hear many, I've heard some pastors stand in a pulpit and say, if you don't believe this way and you don't do this thing, get out of my church. You know, whatever. I think I don't really have much to say to that. What I see more often is a church that preaches love and acceptance and unity, and they stand in their pulpits and they preach away Jesus, but indirectly, the way that they live their lives kind of section people out based on their beliefs. It's more of an indirect passive-aggressive thing rather than a fully aggressive thing. What I see is people coming into churches and they find out that most people in the church believe one way, and they suddenly don't feel welcome because they just don't share that same belief. They find out most of the church votes one way, and they don't vote that way, so they just kind of self-select out. They're like, oh, I don't want that kind of conflict. Don't need no drama in my life, says the great theologian Mary J. Okay, one Mary J. Blige fan. Wow. We have got to open this up. Okay. What I see in churches is we'll say a lot of things publicly, but privately we won't hang out with people that we just are like, mm-mm, they ain't like us. They don't believe what we believe. Think back to that church in Acts 15. In the Jewish culture, the whole circumcision thing, it points back to the Abraham covenant in the book of Genesis. And women weren't circumcised in this Jewish culture. This was a male-only kind of club. You know, if the church had embraced that whole thing, spoiler alert, they don't. But if the church had embraced that whole thing, it would have really given this whole idea that women aren't equal sure footing. Because that wasn't the practice. And up until this point, what we see in the church, we see women being promoted. We see women being empowered in the church. We see women prophesying. We see women coming out and joining in leadership. We don't see women in the church of Jesus being oppressed or repressed. And man, the church is in this pickle, and they got to deal with it. And that's what our text today is really all about. How did the church deal with the issues? Stay united. How did they deal with the conflict? Because the church was made stronger out of this. It wasn't made weaker. The church was made more unified out of it. And I would dare say this, that a spirit-filled church, a church filled with the Holy Spirit, will find themselves more united than divided because of conflict. Sit with that for a minute. I understand why there weren't a lot of amens on that. I'm going to say it again. A spirit, Holy Spirit-filled church. You have people who say, I want to go to a spirit-filled church. I want to see revival. A spirit-filled church will find themselves more united and connected as a result of conflict rather than seeing themselves divided and not having anything to do with each other. You know why I can say that? Because when we read Acts 15 in its entirety, and we keep reading through the New Testament, that's the pattern. That's what we see. We see the church of Jesus. And some of y'all tongue-talking people really have to like come here with me and understand. This is some of the most Pentecostal things that we see out of the New Testament church. That when divisions come up, they're stronger. They're not weaker. Because they have Christ in common. Because they submit to religious and spiritual authority. And I make this big statement, because of what we see in Acts, spirit-filled churches, church conflict should bring us together, not tear us apart. Church conflict should bring us together, not tear us apart. Think about that statement. Think about it. Because, man, I grew up in this town, and we had our share of church conflicts. We had our share of church splits. Maybe you've been a part of a church split before. Maybe you've been a part of a church conflict where just a whole group of people said, we're starting our own church. Y'all are all stupid. Of course, they didn't say that. They said, bless your heart, and called each other sugar and all that kind of stuff because we're all Southern. But they went out and they started, and sometimes churches call it, well, we have a church plant that we're supporting. It ain't no church plant. Y'all couldn't agree on something. That's what it is. And we said, man, I grew up in this town, and I remember what church hurt feels like. And now I'm a pastor, and I really know what church hurt feels like. I really know what conflict and dissension and division. I know how it affects families. I know how it affects my family. But what did they do? They sought counsel. Let's read the next part of the story, starting in verse number 6. So the apostles and elders met together. The leaders of the church met together. And it's not just that church that we were talking about in Syria. They came to Jerusalem, to home base, where all the churches were planted from and came out from. And they all got together. This is one of the reasons I love being a part of a network and a fellowship like the Assemblies of God, because we have accountability. We don't call them bishops, we call them superintendents, but we have spiritual authority, and we come together and we pray, and this is exactly what happened. The apostles and elders met together to resolve this issue. At the meeting, after a long discussion, because y'all know preachers will talk, right? Preachers will just talk and talk and talk. Peter stood and addressed them as follows. Brothers, y'all know that God chose me from among you some time ago to preach to the Gentiles so that they could hear the good news and believe. And he's referring to a story with a Gentile named Cornelius from several chapters prior. God knows people's hearts, and he confirmed that he accepts Gentiles by giving them the Holy Spirit. He made no distinctions between us Jews, and them, for he cleansed their hearts through faith, just as he did us. Verse 10, so why are you now challenging God by burdening the Gentile believers with a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors were able to bear? Peter is calling out the Jewish religious people. He's like, oh, y'all ain't circumcised? Y'all couldn't even do it. And now you're saying they got to do it. Isn't that something that people, like, in a clique come up with? Well, they can be a part of their group if they do this, this, and this. And, like, half of them ain't even done that, that, and that. He says, why are you challenging God? Neither we nor our ancestors were able to bear. We believe that we are all saved the same way by the undeserved grace of the Lord Jesus. And then verse number 12, everyone listened quietly as Barnabas and Paul told about the miraculous signs and wonders God had done among them through the Gentiles. Peter is this leader of the apostles. He's a guy that denied Christ. And then in John chapter 20, Christ restores him. He elevates him to be the leader of the apostles. Peter takes the lead. He preaches the sermon at Pentecost. 3,000 are saved. He stands up and he makes a leadership statement. And I thank God for leaders. I thank God for leaders, because when nobody will like make a decision, and this is going to happen here in about 25 more minutes, y'all are going to leave here. And this is what's going to happen. So what do y'all want for lunch? And it happens every week. What do y'all want? I don't know what you want. I don't care. All right, Taco Bell. I don't want Taco Bell. Well, you said you didn't care. Well, I don't want Taco Bell. What you got against Taco Bell? Man, just get off of Taco Bell. Let's go to Jay's. I don't want to go to Jay's. Why don't you want to go to Jay's? Don't worry about it. I don't want it. Well, how about Blue Bay? I don't want fish. Well, you should have said you didn't want fish. And this just go over. And what do you want? I don't know. And you know what a leader does? A leader goes, hey, Pizza Hut or Jay's? Choose. Everybody in the car, like, chooses. And then they go someplace. Thank God for leaders who just stand up and help people move things forward. Because if they didn't, they'd be arguing about whether they wanted fish or tacos or fish tacos for lunch on Sunday. Fish tacos sound pretty good. Anyway, Peter stands up and he takes leadership. In the middle of the debate and the discussion, he clears up the issue with this huge statement that starts in verse 10. He clears it up and he says, listen. And he just starts telling the story. And in telling the story, makes some very big statements. And we can hold on to these statements. Here's the first statement he makes. That salvation through Jesus is not a burden. This salvation from Jesus is not a burden. Where did the idea come from that getting saved is like swallowing bad-tasting medicine? You remember bad-tasting medicine, right? The cough syrup. Tasted terrible. Now they got cough syrup that tastes like unicorns and bubble gum. I don't know why it happened that way. When I was growing up, cough medicine tasted like the bottom of feet. It was terrible. I know, hold your nose and swallow it down. It'll make you feel better later. That is not how the gospel is. No, following Jesus, salvation is a joy unspeakable. It's a delight. It's not something that I've got a stomach so I can fly away later. In fact, if the only reason I'm getting saved today is so I won't go to hell later, I'm missing out on a big part of what salvation is. If salvation is a burden, something is wrong. If salvation is a burden, somebody has come up with this idea that you've got to do this before you're accepted by God. And it's demonic, straight up. It has nothing to do. It is anti-Christ stinking thinking. And that's what was happening. Can you imagine? Jesus saves. Jesus goes to the cross, has nails through his hands and his feet, is beaten and tortured, and dies on a cross, and he is buried, and he resurrects from a grave. But that's not enough. You've got to do this surgery over here too. If we've got to add to the work that Jesus did, what do we really think Jesus was necessary in the first place? Well, women don't get circumcised, Pastor Peter. Oh, don't worry. We'll come up with some other things to make life unbearable for them. And to this day, this kind of stinking thinking finds its way into the church, into the way that we live. Jesus saves. But only if you don't drink and you don't smoke and you don't go with girls who do. Only if you don't sin. Only if you give money. Only if you attend this event at the church. Only if you bring your kids to church. Only if you give money. Only if you get your kids saved. Only if you hand out pamphlets. Only if you give money. Only if you listen to certain kinds of music. Legalism, 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 give money. And we look down on others. We judge wrongly. And we hear people saying, man, I don't like the church, or I don't like Christians because they're so judgy. Where does that come from? It comes from this idea in Acts chapter 15. This is where it comes from. You can't be saved unless you're circumcised. That is the origination of that whole judginess thing. Friends, Jesus paid the price. Jesus bore the burden. And I would confidently say to you that if you feel burdened by salvation, then you have hitched your life to something other than Jesus Christ. If you feel burdened by salvation, if you don't feel the joy and the freedom that comes from following Christ, what are you saying, that follow Jesus, do anything you want? No. There's discipline and discipleship along the way. Sure. But man, there's not any condemnation. There's no condemnation. Pastor Joe Phillips was my youth pastor back in the 90s, and I'll never forget, like, sitting and just arguing with him over why going to church and the whole Jesus thing was just pointless, because you never could do enough. You could never love Jesus enough. You could never raise your hands enough. You could never get rid of enough music that wasn't Christian. You could never do enough legal things. Like, you always had to be doing something else. And I'll never forget what Joe did. He pulled out his Bible and he went to Romans chapter 8 and he said, Nate, so now there is no condemnation. Can you put that verse up there? There is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. He said, this verse will change your life if you'll just apply it and believe it. When you believe in Christ Jesus, there's no condemnation. Instead of it being a burden that I've got to do all of these things, what I have found is that in following and loving Jesus, man, I can't pray enough. I love it. I can't worship. You know what? When I'm praying and I'm worshiping, I'm not mean. When I'm praying and I'm worshiping and I'm reading scripture and I'm trying to learn about Jesus, I'm trying to follow Jesus, what I find is that I'm not as sarcastic as I was. And y'all know I'm pretty sarcastic. So are you. You know what I've found? In following Jesus, if the more I lean into this, the more hungry for his spirit I am. It is not a burden. It is a joy. And Paul has harsh words throughout the New Testament for the people who make the grace of God difficult for others to receive. He has hard words. You know what he calls them? He calls them mutilators of the gospel. And you don't have to go too far down the line of that metaphor to attach mutilators to circumcision. And oh boy, we got some problems. Listen to what he says in Philippians 3. This isn't in your notes, but in Philippians 3, he says this: watch out for the dogs, the people who do evil, the mutilators who say you must be circumcised to be saved. For we who worship by the Spirit of God are the ones who are truly circumcised. Now, circumcision was a sign of the covenant. And Paul is taking this out in metaphor in such a very, very in-your-face kind of way. He's saying, they're saying that you have to do this. I'm saying to you, we are already there, and they are not even a part of what Jesus is doing. Because they're adding to that. They are mutilating the gospel. They are carving it up. There's another translation of the Bible that says, these knife-happy circumcisers. Oh, it just sounds evil. It sounds like something that you would see like on Netflix. Another statement we see in this council is this. So the first one is salvation is not a burden. Another thing we see Peter say is that salvation is not just for one group of people. Go back to verses 10 and 11. Here's what he says. So why are you now challenging God by burdening the Gentile believers with a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors were able to bear? We believe that we are all saved the same way by the undeserved grace of the Lord Jesus. Salvation is not just for one group of people. It's not just for the Jews, and it's not just for the Assembly of God people. It's not just for the Baptist people. It's not just for the Catholic people, the Presbyterians, or the great big spaghetti head monster people. Whatever. No. Back in the day, the original promise to Father Abraham. If you heard of Father Abraham, he has many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. I'm one of them, so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. Right arm. Father Abraham. Any of y'all go to that Sunday school class? The original promise out of Genesis 17 says this: this is my covenant. This is God talking to Abraham. This is my covenant with you. I will make you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you the father of what? A multitude of nations. I will make you the father of one nation. A multitude of nations. Along the way, the Jewish people seemed to disregard that whole word multitude. They assumed everybody had to become like them and become Jewish. And how many times have you heard one church of Jesus disparage another church of Jesus? Or one Christian talking bad about another Christian? Or one pastor publicly shaming another pastor? Or a denomination? How many times have you heard Assemblies of God and Pentecostals making fun of Catholics? Or Baptists making fun of Pentecostals? Can I tell you something? None of our man-made denominations, none of our man-made fellowships can separate us from God's grace and love. None of us are powerful enough. We don't have the power to look at another denomination and start saying that they are wrong. If they are holding Jesus as the Savior, if they are preaching the same good news, if they are holding Scripture and with who Jesus is as the way, man, we can disagree on a lot of other stuff, but if we hold Jesus in common, we don't have the power to remove the grace of God from people's lives. But you know what will separate us from God? Sin. Sin separates us from God. Harming each other is sin. The idea that one group or one fellowship is superior or more dominating than the next is very dangerous. Not to mention the division that just comes as a part of our culture. Race, ethnicity, political, wealth. Oh, friends, how easy is it for us to use the things that divide us as humans? How easy is it for us to use the things that divide us as Americans and believe that our way is the right way? For us to have our opinions and our ideas, and to not only believe it, but to believe it so strongly that we believe that God believes it with us. How dangerous is it that we take our man-made opinions and we slap it on morality and we slap our opinions into Scripture? Gang, the church should be the one place on earth where different people can be different and still be connected together because of the man who hung on the cross. Because there's more power in the cross than there is in my opinion. There's more power in the cross than there is in the things you like or don't like. There's more power in the cross, not to mention in the resurrection and the explosion from death to life. That is beautiful. Salvation is not a burden. Salvation is not just for one group of people who gets it right. I don't believe that when we go to heaven one day that the Holy Father is going to look at us and say, now tell me about your doctrine of predestination before I let you in. I don't think it's going to happen. I don't. Salvation is not a burden. Salvation is not for one group of people. And lastly, we see Peter saying this, salvation is about grace. Will you say grace? Full, unmerited grace. There's a story that Jesus told in Luke chapter 10. It's very, very familiar. Even if you didn't go to Sunday school, you've probably heard the story. It's the story of the Good Samaritan. You ever heard that story? Raise your hand if you heard the story of the Good Samaritan before. Okay, about 50% of the crowd. Those of you that didn't raise your hands, you're either lying or you've really never heard it before, because that's how truth goes. The story of the Good Samaritan goes this way. A good Jewish man was going on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho, or Jericho to Jerusalem. I forget which way he was going. But he had to go through the hill country. And a group of robbers and bandits came out, and they beat him up, left him for dead. They beat him, left him naked on the road, bleeding out, black eyes, broken ribs, you name it. And a good Jewish religious leader comes by, sees him, gets on the other side of the road, doesn't help him. A Levite comes by. You know, all these good Jewish people come by and they see him. They go to the other side. They pretend they don't see him. And then a Samaritan comes by. Now, a Samaritan was hated by the Jews, and Samaritans hated the Jews. And what did the Samaritan do? He's called good because he bandaged the guy up. He helped the guy out. He put him on his donkey, took him into town. He put him up in a room. He made sure that he had medicine. He made sure that he got taken care of. He had to leave, but he left money for the innkeeper to take care of him. And that's the story of the Good Samaritan. We love when grace comes our way. If you're on the side of the road, it doesn't matter the color of the person's skin or what they believe. Whatever, if they help you, you like them. If you're sitting there banged up, bloody, and somebody comes and they help you, everybody appreciates when grace is given. But it is difficult, it is inconvenient to give grace to others. In fact, I think that's a good word for grace. Inconvenient. It's inconvenient to stop my road trip to pay attention to the hurting person on the side of the road. Because I was trying the whole time to beat the Google Map estimated time. I wanted to get to my vacation. I wanted to get to that place. I wanted to get to the next rest stop. I didn't want to stop and help somebody. Well, nobody will think bad of me if I just didn't see them. Grace is inconvenient, and we all love it when we're shown grace. But man, it's difficult sometimes to show grace to others, and you don't understand how wonderful grace is until you need it. I think sometimes that's why it's really easy to not give grace to others. Because we haven't fully understood and realized our own need for grace. How much Christ has saved us and helped us and loved us. Through people in his church, through people. And here's the big challenge. It's going to come up on the screen. Will we use God's given love and grace as a way of boosting our own sense of security? Or will we see it as a call and a challenge to extend that love and grace to the whole world? Read that a couple times. Do I see God's grace to me only? Do I see God's given love and grace as a way that just makes me feel better, feel more secure? Or am I challenged by His grace? Am I called by His grace to give it as well? See, salvation from Jesus is not a burden. Salvation from Jesus is not just for a group of people. And salvation from Jesus is about unmerited grace. I love the words of N.T. Wright. He says, no church, no Christian can remain content with the easy definitions which allow us to watch most of the world lying half dead in the road. He's speaking specifically about the Good Samaritan and applying it to our lives. And he's saying no church, no Christian can be content with just an easy definition of grace that allows us to watch the world lying half dead along the road. And finally, in verse 19, I'll close with this, and our team will come and just play some nice music behind me. James, the apostle. See, Peter was seen as the leader of the apostles. James, the brother of Jesus, was seen as the head of the church, the leader of the church. And he says this, and so my judgment is this, based on all that they talked about and everything that Peter said, my judgment is this, we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. We should not make it difficult for the people who are turning to God. We should not make it difficult for people to see the grace of God. We should not make it difficult. We should live by this grace. It should drive us. And I remind you again, the Holy Spirit is doing something in you that will live beyond you. The Holy Spirit is doing something in you that will outlast you. Ask you the same question. Who are you in this story? Where do you fit? Are you one of the Gentiles that just heard about Jesus and you didn't grow up in church, or you didn't attend church, or you don't have this religious background, or maybe you're still growing up and you're hearing about it? And you don't have this long history, but you heard about Jesus, and you know that whatever the guy that raised from the dead, whatever the guy who come out of the grave says, I'm following him. Maybe you find yourself as one of those people who's like, man, I like this grace because I have tried this on my own. I have been so burdened with sin and the ways that I want to do things in my control and my life and me. And if Jesus is the way, sign me up. Maybe you've seen salvation as a burden. Maybe somebody has put something in the way and said, you can only be saved if you do these things. Maybe you're hearing for the first time, maybe, words from Scripture saying it shouldn't be a burden to follow this Jesus. It shouldn't be a burden to be a part of the church of Jesus. Maybe you didn't think you were good enough to be a part of the group. Maybe you didn't think you were good enough or smart enough or the right color or the right creed or the right culture. Maybe you didn't think you had enough wealth. You didn't give enough. And maybe you're hearing now from Scripture, there shouldn't be anything that keeps anybody from Jesus. I want you to know salvation is for you. Maybe you're a person in the story who's sitting around the table going, but I thought you had to do this. But I thought, but what about this? But what about this? And for everything that said, you've always got a butt. Maybe Jesus is saying, hey, get your butts out of the way. Just get them out of the way. There's no conjunction. There's nothing else but Jesus that puts you right with the Father. Maybe you need to ask for forgiveness and grace. Maybe you've made it hard for somebody else. Maybe you've judged and you've got some shame around that. Maybe you need to ask God to forgive you for making it harder for others. Maybe there's somebody in your life that you just don't have that grace for them yet. And you're like, you know what, God, I need you to do a work in me so that I can extend your grace and forgiveness to that guy, to that lady. Maybe you find yourself around the table arguing, and you hear the apostle come out and say, we should not make it difficult for anybody. And instead of arguing back with the apostle, instead of arguing with scripture, you're at this place where you're going, okay, fine, I concede, but I need help. This big statement I made at the beginning, that conflict and division should actually draw us closer together, it starts with humility in these moments. And maybe you're at a place of asking for forgiveness for that. Would you stand with me? I want to pray over both groups of people. And if you don't struggle with any of this, congratulations. You will one day. You will. You may have your theology right today, but there's going to come a day where your own pride or your own belief or your own opinion is going to challenge you. I pray that same prayer over you that James stood up and prayed and said. I pray those same words of you that the Apostle Peter said. There is nothing burdensome about salvation. There is nothing, no group or clique of people you have to be a part of. It's all about the grace of Jesus. In the name of Jesus the Christ, bow your heads with me. Father God, we stand before you with our hands raised to you, palms facing upward, and we say, we, your church, we, your people, receive your grace freely. We, your people, will not stand in the way of your grace for others. We will fast track grace to people. We won't stand in the way. We will not make salvation a burden. We will not make following Jesus a burden. We will do everything in our power to make it a joy, to bring God's kingdom come here on earth today. Some of us here today are following Jesus for the first time, or maybe you're rededicating your life. Belief in that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Belief in Jesus the Christ. I pray God's blessing over you. I pray the joy of the Holy Spirit drives your week harder than anything else that comes your way. That's my prayer over you. God, make us more and more a church like this New Testament church, where our divisions and our opinions bring us together rather than tears us apart, because we can seek you together and we can live in humility together. We lay down our opinions at the foot of the cross. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Now before we close and pray, I said that we had an announcement at the end of the service today. I want to ask Pastor Lily to join me up here. We've got a little bit of news that is kind of exciting and a little sad, but more exciting than sad. Pastor Lily and I have been talking since April, beginning of May. And you know what she told me? Ever since the fighting started happening in Ukraine, she told me, Pastor Nate, I've got to be with the kids over there. Pastor Nate, I'm a nurse practitioner, and I've felt this calling for medical missions on my life. And you know what I had to do? I had to pray about that. And I had to be reminded that, you know what? Pastor Lily doesn't belong to this church. She doesn't belong to me. She doesn't belong to you. She belongs to God. And we're going to do everything we can to push her into what God's will is for her life. Would you mind sharing with us what you feel like God's called you to do?
Yeah, you can be seated if you want to. I won't be too long. It's not sad. It's wonderful when you listen to what God has put on your heart. Those of you that really, really know me know that my intention has been when I retire that I would be a medical missionary. And the Lord, at the beginning of this year, started whispering into my heart that it was time that I stopped doing everything and I started doing the things that only I could do for him. And then the Ukraine happened. And my heart since, and Dr. Ken knows this, I've told him, my heart since that happened is, and I've seen the rooms of children and the mothers, is like, why aren't you there already, Pastor Lily? See, God has a place for everyone. And God has his love for everyone, and there are, and God cares when disasters happen in this world, and he has people that he prepares to march when he gives direction and to take his love there. So my heart since whenever Ukraine happened was that I have a desire to go and to be over there. I've, as of July the 31st will be my last day as children's pastor here. It has been a wonderful journey. You are a wonderful church family. I'm not leaving the family. When I am going with Samaritan's Purse, so they have clinics and hospitals. I've been a nurse practitioner for 34 years before I ever had my children. And I'll go for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks at a time, and then I'll come home. My home is Albemarle. My church is Albemarle First Assembly. If this church ever burned down, you'll find me in the ashes rebuilding it. This is my church. I love this church. I love this family. But God has also given me direction. So all of the normal things I've done with normal medicine, normal people, normal children all these years, God has trained me that now I'm going to dip into a little bit of the abnormal. So more of the disaster. I have a heart to go as soon as they'll take me, even as early as September. And then I'll come back and people will say, well, what about your dear husband? I've been married 40 years to the same man and I don't have any intent to marry it, to have any other. So once I get, he's at the, down at the homeless shelter this morning helping down there.
He's right back
there. Did he come back in?
He's back, yeah.
Where are you?
Come on up here, Bruce.
Come up
here. I know
you
don't want to, but do it anyway.
So a lady pastor and a lady missionary could never be one without a wonderful husband who is willing to listen to that. We met 42 years ago at Indianapolis Teen Challenge. He worked with the boys and I worked with the girls, and it went from there. And then we've raised three wonderful boys ourselves who are well established with the Lord. And so we feel very comfortable that once I'm established, that we can look around and see what Bruce can do too. So he'll come with me once we figure it all out. So anyway, we're going to take that dive. So we have wonderful, we're better off here at First Assembly with wonderful workers than we've ever been. Pastor Nate will share, I guess, where we're going with that. But anyway, I feel very comfortable, and I've already shared with the children this morning, they're not surprised that I would be a missionary. We've talked missions over and over and over. Someday some of them may join me. Who knows? Someday maybe some of you might join me on some travels. But for the next 10 years of my life, I plan to be a missionary. So that's where we're going. I feel like that God wants me to delve into the medicine side of it and then to find the kids, to find out where they've got the kids and the mamas gathered and show up and tell a story, to share with them what's on my heart. And that's where we're going. So God bless you. All the Wilson boys will be home on July 31st. If anybody wants to say hey to them, they'll be here.
Oh, wait, whoa, 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 come back. Come back, don't leave. Come back, come back. I need you to pray. We need to pray over you. Come back. Oh, no, no, no. Will y'all support Bruce and Lily, as Pastor Lily, as they move forward? Could you just stretch your hands out towards them? In the name of Jesus, we bless you. Pastor Lily and Bruce, we bless you. We are humbled and honored to stand with you and make the gospel of Jesus easier for suffering people over the world. I don't know what it looks like yet, but we support you. We'll support you financially. We'll support you with our love, with our prayers. We love you. And we are so honored. We get to be your church. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, before we close in prayer, I'm going to actually have Pastor Lily close us in prayer. And she's going to bless you, okay? A couple of things. Some of y'all know Miss Jackie Helms and Misty Boss. They're stepping into our children's pastor roles this month. and we'll introduce them to you at a later time if you haven't met them yet. But we're excited about that. They're excited to be in this role. Pastor Lily's been working with them throughout this month, and she's going to lay her hands on them and bless them before she leaves publicly. We're all going to get behind them. And lastly, on the 31st of July, after the morning service, that's a Sunday. So after that service, we're going to have this reception with food and hugs and gifts, lots of generosity. And we're just going to lavish and honor Bruce and Pastor Lily, right? Yeah. And when somebody at lunch says today, can you believe Pastor Lily's leaving? You go like this. You go, of course. She has to do what God told her to do. Don't you dare be one of these people who does the nye-nye-nye-nye thing. And you know exactly what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. We pray this prayer every week. We're going to pray it, and then Pastor Lily is going to pray a blessing over us. It's going to come up over the screens with your hands outstretched and your palms facing up. We are image bearers of the Most High God. We are covered by the love of Jesus. We have the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit within us. Because of the Holy Spirit's power within us, we will freely and recklessly give away this love of Jesus. We won't hold back. Amen.